Thanks. My name is Jake Burchek. I'm a medical oncologist here at Dana-Farber, at the Lank Center for Genitourinary Oncology. I'll be presenting the prostate cancer updates from ASCO 2023 with a distinguished discussant, Dr. Mary Ellen Taplin, to provide commentary at the end. I'm going to try to get through six of the oral presentations. We'll spend a little bit more time on the first few, but I think some interesting points. I provided a few conclusions here up front, which I'll just briefly go through and then go into a little bit more of the data in the slides. So the first was the randomized phase 3 Talipro 2 study, which was initially presented at ASCO GU earlier this year, looking at talazoparib and enzalutamide versus enzalutamide in first-line mCRPC. It showed an improvement in RPFS in the HRR-positive population, the addition of talazoparib, and spoiler alert, this led to a recent FDA approval for this combination in first-line mCRPC for patients with HR-altered prostate cancer, so really a practice-changing study. The second is updated results of piece one focused on the role of radiation in addition to either doublet or triplet therapy for patients with metastatic hormone sensitive prostate cancer. No improvement in overall survival, but there was improvement in a few secondary outcomes, or I should say other clinical outcomes, which we'll go into. LuPARP was an exciting phase one study of lutetium PSMA in combination with olaparib that showed manageable safety and promising clinical activity with a higher response rate than was seen with Pluvicto alone in the VISION study. I think maybe one of the most exciting abstracts presented in prostate was data on Artera AI, a pathology AI-based biomarker that showed really nice, not only prognostic, but also strong predictive value for identifying men with localized high-risk prostate cancer who do or don't benefit from hormone therapy. The ICECAP collaborative, there was data presented from our very own Dr. Praful Ravi looking at the prognostic value of PSA nadir greater than 0.1 in patients getting radiation and hormone therapy and or with or without hormone therapy for localized prostate cancer, showing that if the nadir doesn't go below 0.1, that's strongly prognostic for poor MFS, prostate mortality, and overall survival. And then finally, some nice data from a consortium looking at prognosis of mCRPC patients based on the presence of BRCA or other HRR alterations, showing that BRCA was associated with poor prognosis, followed by non-BRCA HR alterations, followed by patients who don't have those alterations. Go into a little bit more detail. I'm going to go quickly for the sake of time, but open to questions at the end. So first, the Talipro 2 study. As I mentioned, this was first-line mCRPC. Patients were allowed to get prior abiraterone or docetaxel in the hormone-sensitive in the metastatic hormone-sensitive setting. And patients were stratified by whether they received those and HR gene status, if it was known. Patients received enzalutamide with placebo or with talazoparib, and overall survival or radiographic progression-free survival was the primary endpoint. You can see here the list of HR gene alterations, and I'll comment a little bit more on that at the end. Talipro 2 was initially presented at ASCO GU, looking at the overall cohort. This presentation focused on the HRR mutant population, this cohort 2. I'm going to skip over this for the most part. Just mentioned a pretty low proportion of patients received abiraterone in the metastatic hormone-sensitive setting. About 30% received docetaxel. And then I think an important point is that pretty much, you know, 98, 99% of patients underwent tumor tissue testing as well as liquid biopsy. You can see BRCA2, the most commonly altered gene, pretty well balanced between the talazoparib and the placebo group. And here's the top line results looking at RPFS in the HR deficient population. And you can see there was a more than 50% reduction in the risk of progression, radiographic progression in patients receiving talazoparib in combination with enzalutamide. Subgroup analysis is important. You can see, for the most part, a really consistent benefit favoring the addition of talazoparib. Highlighted at the bottom is the subgroups based on BRCA1/2 alterations versus other HR alterations. You can see 80% reduction in RPFS with in patients with BRCA1/2 with the addition of talazoparib. The hazard ratio was 0.72 for other HR alterations, and the confidence interval did cross one. They did a little bit more granularity around the specific alterations. We'll just point out that the magnitude of benefit is clear in the BRCA patients. For the others, there's sort of a gradient with varying degrees of benefit with the addition of talazoparib. The overall survival data was immature, 24% of the required events, but did trend in the right direction, hazard ratio of 0.69 with a p-value of 0.068. Time to PSA progression strongly favored talazoparib, as did time to cytotoxic chemotherapy and PFS too. The response rate was impressively higher, 67% versus objective response rate compared to 40%, with 38% of patients achieving a complete response compared to 18.5%. And side effects were largely in line with what was has previously been reported for the independent drugs. Side effects were largely cytopenias with the addition of talazoparib and fatigue, as expected. And patient reported this patient reported outcome of clinical deterioration also favored the addition of talazoparib. So they concluded that talazoparib with enzalutamide has the potential to become a first line treatment option for patients with mCRPC and HR gene alterations, with the caveat if approved. 8 days ago, June 20th, FDA did approve talazoparib and enzalutamide for first-line mCRPC in patients with HR gene alterations. I did note here the specific genes that were included in the FDA approval, and just with the commentary that it does slightly differ from the list of genes that were studied in the PROFOUND study, I highlighted in bold the ones that are unique to talazoparib and enzalutamide and the ones that are unique to olaparib. In total, if you look at the two lists, there are 19 genes now where there is FDA approval for a PARP inhibitor, either alone or in combination with an AR pathway inhibitor. Moving on to results of the PIECE 1 study. This was again focused on looking at the addition of radiation to standard of care systemic therapy. Here's the study design. We've looked at this before, so I'm gonna move on. Co-primary endpoints were RPFS and overall survival, with key secondary endpoints that they did comment on here. We'll note that in the overall study, about 40% were low volume, 57% were high volume. Much of the results presented here focused on the low volume cohort. So here's the RPFS for the low volume population. You can see that that in the group that received abiraterone, the addition of radiation was associated with a significant improvement in radiographic progression-free survival with a hazard ratio of 0.65 and a p-value of 0.02. That's when looked at the subgroup independently. And the patients who didn't get abiraterone, interestingly, there was no benefit with the addition of radiation. When you look at the combined groups, whether or not patients received abiraterone, there was a significant improvement in radiographic progression-free survival. There was no difference in overall survival, but if you do look at the curves, the curve in black, the patients who received abi and radiation, those patients didn't seem to do the best, but was not statistically significant. Another outcome they report on is serious genitourinary events listed here. I'll note that there were fewer in the group that did receive radiation, but that was really driven by patients receiving less radiation or TURP. And so if the patients getting radiation get less subsequent radiation, that doesn't seem like a terribly exciting clinical outcome to me. But they did report that the addition of radiation was associated with a significant reduction or improvement in the risk of serious genitourinary events, whether or not patients received abiraterone. And that's true in the low volume population as well as the overall population. The addition of radiation, whether or not patients received abiraterone was associated with a delay in the time to castration resistance in the low volume and overall population, and radiation was associated with minimal and expected toxicity. So they concluded that, you know, in patients who were undergoing standard of care systemic therapy with ADT and docetaxel plus minus abiraterone, the addition of radiation did improve clinical outcomes, specifically PFS, RPFS, and serious genitourinary events. It did not improve overall survival, but they did conclude that it could be considered as a standard of care in men with de novo low volume disease in combination with systemic therapy. Moving on to the LuPARP study, as I mentioned, a phase one of Pluvicto in combination with olaparib, just background on the prior clinical data and preclinical data. The hypothesis was that the combination would of olaparib would radiosensitize to Pluvicto, improve efficacy. The primary endpoint was safety, with secondary endpoints of anti-tumor activity. Here's the design. It was a dose escalation in 3+3 design. I'll just note here, olaparib wasn't given throughout the entire 6 weeks. You can see, depending on which cohort, it was given either days 2 to 15 after treatment with Pluvicto, up to in cohort 9, day 4 before Pluvicto and continuing 18 days after. They were looking at dose limiting criteria, toxicity listed there. This is a schema. Really, toxicity was in line with what we would expect. And actually, this combination was really quite well tolerated across all 9 cohorts. There were no DLTs observed. And here's the PSA response, is waterfall plot, really nice waterfall plot in terms of PSA response. And here is a swimmer plot showing the both the PSA as well as radiographic responses, and some patients with really nice durable responses. The patients at the bottom here were in the most recent cohort with limited follow-up. So they concluded that these were really quite well tolerated, no DLTs observed, and there did seem to be promising clinical activity that actually exceeded a response rate seen in Vision. And so really exciting potential new combination. This was one of the abstracts that I thought was maybe the most interesting, looking at this AI biomarker, Artera AI, essentially asking the question of, can we identify men with high-risk localized prostate cancer with a low risk of metastasis who could benefit, or who would, where short-term ADT would be suitable versus those who need long-term ADT. I'm going to skip over a lot of the background just to say that at ASCO GU 2022, Dan Spratt presented data with similar biomarker showing that in the intermediate risk population, they could identify patients who were biomarker negative, who did not benefit from the addition of short-term ADT with radiation, versus those who were biomarker positive and did benefit from the addition of short-term ADT. Here they were looking at the high-risk population. So this is showing the trials that were included, a little bit of the features that were included in the AI model. This just shows that really the image, the H&E of the biopsy was the most informative feature that went into the AI model, but there were additional clinical and pathologic features that went in. And the study design, essentially, they included several trials and then validated it in this NRG RTOG 9202 study of patients who were randomized with mostly high risk, but some intermediate risk, who were randomized to receive long-term versus short-term ADT. So here are the results in the overall cohort. You can see that this is the overall study, that long-term ADT reduced the risk of distant metastasis compared to short-term ADT with a hazard ratio of 0.64. Now here's with biomarker stratification. On the left are the 407 patients who are biomarker negative. And you can see in that population, there was no benefit to the addition of, or to long-term ADT versus short-term ADT in preventing metastatic disease. However, in the biomarker positive group, 2/3 of the patients approximately, there was a significant reduction in the risk of distant metastases, hazard ratio of 0.55, with the long-term versus short-term ADT and an interaction of value of p equals 0.04. Here, this shows that this AI biomarker did a better job or was statistically significant, and actually risk group, high risk, very high risk versus NCCN intermediate risk was not significantly predictive of which patients benefit from long-term versus short-term ADT. This is now overall survival or death with distant metastases. And we see a similar result where the biomarker is able to identify patients who benefit or predict patients who with long-term ADT will have a reduction in death with distant metastases with long-term ADT. Looking at subgroup analysis, this just shows that the biomarker for all of these clinical outcomes really trends towards being predictive. Not all of them reach statistical significance, but I think this is really neat, this clinical impact. With this, using this biomarker in this cohort, if this played out in real clinical practice, 29% of patients with NCCN high-risk disease would benefit from treatment shortening shortening ADT, given the lack of benefit of long-term ADT on distant metastasis and death. In addition, 43% of patients with intermediate risk disease could benefit from treatment intensification with long-term ADT to reduce those clinical outcomes. And then finally, despite long-term ADT, about 20% of men with high-risk localized prostate cancer developed distant metastasis and died of prostate cancer. So could this identify patients for treatment intensification? So I think a really neat study that could inform practice over the coming years. Dr. Praful Ravi, given time, I'm gonna go quickly through this, but our colleague Dr. Ravi presented data from ICECAP looking at the prognostic impact of PSA nadir greater than 0.1 in patients with localized prostate cancer receiving with or without radiation. I'm gonna cut to the chase. I think this slide nicely shows the results of this analysis that PSA greater than nadir greater than 0.1 really across metastasis-free survival, prostate cancer-specific mortality, overall survival, regardless or in patients who receive radiation alone, short-term ADT or long-term ADT, really this biomarker was associated with poor prognosis. So really quite helpful for understanding prognosis in the clinical setting, as well as thinking about trial design intensification, potentially for patients with this poor risk factor. And I believe finally, this was a study looking at clinical outcomes for patients with mCRPC receiving first-line treatment by BRCA status. Again, I'm gonna cut to the chase here, but what they found is that overall survival was significantly worse for patients who had BRCA alterations compared to non-BRCA, and BRCA compared to HRR, other HRR alterations. This was actually independent of whether the BRCA alterations were somatic versus germline, or whether there was monoallelic or biallelic loss. And here they show the outcomes from first-line mCRPC on. You can see that the BRCA patients do worse with first-line, second-line, and treatment and overall survival, followed by the HRR non-BRCA altered patients, followed by all comers, and then patients without BRCA alterations have the best outcomes. And again, this is showing that no difference. These observations hold whether patients got taxane or ARSI first, whether the alteration was germline or somatic, biallelic, monoallelic, or BRCA 1 or BRCA 2. So in conclusion, I think we have a study that led to a new FDA-approved first-line therapy of enzalutamide with talazoparib in patients with HRR-altered mCRPC. We need to see, or I think it'll be important to see the overall survival data as that matures, but I think an exciting new option for those patients. The addition of radiation to systemic therapy and mHSPC improves some clinical outcomes, but not overall survival. And so I think supports that this is an option for some patients, but maybe not mandatory given the absence of an OS benefit. The LuPARP combination of lutetium and olaparib looks really promising, and I imagine is going to go on to further phase two, if not phase three study. And then I really think this AI biomarker has potential to inform how we decide on which patients get systemic therapy, get hormone therapy in the localized setting, and how long, where we really lack great clinical biomarkers to make that determination. With that, I will open it up to Dr. Taplin for any commentary, and feel free to put any questions in the chat.
Thanks, Jake. Wonderful presentation, and congratulations to all the presenters. Really, this meeting is one of my favorites, and I always learn a lot. Regarding the prostate cancer work, I agree with Jake. The TALAPRO study gives us another option in first-line mCRPC of ENZA plus a PARP inhibitor, and that will need to be considered in light of the ABBEY data from PROPEL with a PARP inhibitor. So now there's two choices FDA approved in HR mutated patients. It's a more controversial issue and wasn't FDA approved in non-altered patients, but that may come up in conversation with some of your patients. And I think the underlying messages here is you need to be consistently testing these patients for germline mutations and when you're able for somatic mutations, either by tissue, as was done in this study in a remarkable high percentage of patients, as Jake noted, which was not always the case in some of the other studies. So this data is very believable and should now be considered in your standard of care treatments for prostate cancer patients. For me, the piece one data didn't really change standard of care because we've been given prostate radiation with low volume MS hormone sensitive prostate cancer, and I'll continue to do that. And I don't think it really changed my mind to give prostate radiation for high volume patients, although the discussion at ASCO was along those lines. But as Jake pointed out, I wasn't totally convinced that the improvement in the GU-related consequences was that significant. I'm also excited about the possible combination of Pluvicto and a PARP that may be in all comers as opposed to just the DDR-altered patients. And that combination has really very good biologic rationale compared to a lot of combinations that get moved forward. So I think with this early phase one data, it's very promising. I agree with Jake about the Atera biomarker work, and we'll just point out if you saw those curves, they were coming apart at 5 years. There is almost no data in localized prostate cancer where any curves come apart at 5 years or anything. So it's really strong data, very well done. I think the biomarker itself is quite a mystery. Like, there's very little that's been published, probably because of proprietary information about what they're actually measuring, which I'm very interested to learn more about. But I think that, you know, has the potential to really help us personalize the duration of ADT for our prostate cancer patients, which is very important. I'll just congratulate Praful on his presentation. It was excellent. And I don't have really too much to say about the Elena Castro data, except continue to test all your patients for germline mutations in prostate cancer. And a controversial area is whether patients with localized prostate cancer should be germline tested, low-risk prostate cancer. I am a strong personal believer that they should be. It's not currently in the NCCN guidelines because I don't think patients with especially BRCA2 mutations are very good candidates for active surveillance. So I just went down a pet peeve path, but you know, that's gonna come up, and I personally do it and recommend that you think about it. Germline testing in low-risk prostate cancer patients. And that's all. Great. I have to say.
Thanks, Mary Ellen. So many good pearls there. Can I follow up on something that you brought up, which I think is really important, pushing testing, the importance of germline somatic testing. With now the approvals in the first line mCRPC setting, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I'm going to. When are you going to be doing somatic testing now? I mean, should knowing that this is now approved for first-line mCRPC, should we be moving our practice to doing somatic testing at the time of metastatic diagnosis so that we have that information lined up to know about the somatic BRCA, the somatic PALB2, when they're progressing on first-line therapy to be able to give talazoparib enzalutamide?
Yeah, I think it's very easy to say that we should be doing it. I think in practice, it's very difficult to do just because of the bone met predominance nature of the disease. And half the time, even in a very experienced place like ours, when you do a bone biopsy, it does not go all the way to sequencing. So I think, yes, like we should put extra effort into doing it. I think a bigger question is, should we be sequencing all the tissue from the prostatectomies? So I wasn't previously doing that because it was such a long number of years before they got to their metastatic disease. But I think since that tissue is available and is useful information, I might start doing that more than I have traditionally been doing.
One question from the chat. From Henry Cornelius. Thank you, Henry. Any therapies coming online for patients with somatic P10 mutated prostate cancer? I think we're familiar with Dr. Sweeney's hepatocertib study and that was unfortunately not, you know, moved forward, despite, I think, promising clinical activity in P10 deficient mCRPC. But curious, Mary Ellen, anything you know of in the works?
That's been my biggest frustration. I came to Dana-Farber 20 years ago to develop therapeutics in, you know, P10 mutated patients with Bill Sellers and others. And, you know, 20 years later, there's nothing. I don't know of anything. I know there's some phase one trials that are going on with, you know, other compounds. I don't know what's going to end up with them. It's been a very disappointing area in prostate cancer.
Thanks. And then Dr. Schwery put a question in the chat about treating with PARP outside of BRCA, any HRR, what about ctDNA? So I think the evidence just is overwhelmingly, you know, again and again clear that BRCA patients derive the most benefit. So, you know, I think testing early to find those and treat with PARP essentially as soon as patients develop CRPC is how I'm going to approach it. For other alterations, I think it's more of a case by case, you know, a germline PALB2, I think probably with a second, you know, with loss of heterozygosity, I think has a high chance of responding. I would probably prioritize doing enza-tal in the first line mCRPC setting for a, you know, random ATM or sort of a mutation, one of the long list of genes without a second copy loss. I maybe wouldn't rush to it when if I had docetaxel and Pluvicto and maybe other treatments that might have a greater benefit. Certainly, you know, I'm going to give it some point, but I think how much I'm prioritizing depends on the alteration. I think ctDNA, we'll see. It certainly, as Mary Ellen was saying, is an alternative when we can't get tissue, which is true for a lot of our patients with metastatic prostate cancer, given bone predominance. But cell-free DNA, unless there's an exceedingly high amount of tumor circulating in circulation, which isn't most patients, it's going to miss two copy deletions, which are probably the most predictive of PARP response in some of the correlative studies. So I think ctDNA and tissue are complementary. If you can get tissue, I think that's probably preferable. In cases where you can't get tissue, I think ctDNA is a great alternative, but know that a negative may be a false negative in a subset of patients.